Yeah, we are good
You're
to go.
live. You're live.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to this edition of Cashless Consumers Payment Deep Dives. In today's session, we'll be looking at account aggregators. We have with us Rohit Killam, who's head of technology at Aditya Birla Finance. And he's been working on the account aggregator framework. And we also are joined by Vinay Sathyanarayana, who is a director of engineering at Periforce Account Aggregators. So broadly, we would want to keep this session focusing on the technology aspects of privacy and security on data sharing in the account aggregator framework. So we'll have Vinay present and then Rohit talk about the various privacy and security aspects from a technical standpoint. And then we have a bunch of questions lined up and we'll have a discussion to that. We're also joined by Suchana Seth, who will be moderating the discussion. I think I'll leave the floor to Vinay now. For those of you joining through the YouTube chat, you're welcome to post your comments on the YouTube chat and we'll have them answered here. And we'll probably have these as a more of an interactive session. So at any point of time, if you have any questions, Vinay, over to you.
Yeah. Thanks, Srikanth. I hope I'm audible for everyone. So I do see a lot of questions in the comment section. So hopefully, this presentation will cover many of them. So I presume my screen is visible. We'll just spend a couple of minutes on understanding AA for the larger audience. I'm not sure if everyone is on the same page. And so what is the fundamental problem and the need for the AAs? The consumers are ready to build the, share the data for various use cases, whether it's a lending or a wealth advisory or a, any analysis on the financial data, etc. There's absolutely no control. In fact, if you look at one of those public sector banks or any of those banks, you see piles of printouts laying around of financial data. Similarly, there are service providers, but they don't have a regulated way of giving the data in a digital way. There's no guarantee of the authenticity. So there's a mistrust in this case. For example, if somebody comes in for a loan purpose, I can speak specifically for lending purposes, they come and take your printout of ITRV, Aadhaar, bank statement, and etc. And then take this and dump it into your back office. The back office is keep piling on those printouts, you visit the office, you have those things.
Vinay, just a second.
Yes,
yeah, your audio is slightly breaking, or we're hearing a lot of noise. Can you
Any better now?
Or there's slight echo, or I don't know, there's some jazzy sound along with your audio.
Any better now, Srikanth?
Yeah, it's probably better, yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Srikanth. So this is a fundamental problem. There's a consumer and service provider, and there's a mistrust among them because there's no direct way of sharing this data with a lot of trust. So the solution is the account aggregator, where a very five-step process. It is based on a backed by consent. The consent is defined by the Ministry of Information Technology. It needs to be fetched, consolidated, and aggregated data, basic questions there. And the citizen or the who is the data actual data owner is the one who will approve the consent, and there is a granularity of the consent. So it's called as an organs principle. Many of you have heard it. So it goes to all the granularity, what is the purpose, what is the intention behind the consent, etc. We'll go through those flow also. So similarly, there are three parts to this, three major players into this. One is in financial information provider who is providing the data. It could be a bank, GSTN, AMC, mutual fund houses, securities, insurance, etc. And then there is a financial information user who is using this data for an intended purpose. It could be a lending, credit monitoring, more from wealth advisory, PFM, various things, credit card, etc. And then there is an account aggregator who is a consent manager who says that without a consent being approved by the citizen, account aggregator will not pass this data. Note that account aggregator is data blind, which means the transport that happens from an FIP to FIU, account aggregator doesn't know. So it is more of a courier. So this is the rough size, how the market is growing, whether it's a lending or a PFM or a wealth, insurance, travel, visa processing. For example, today, if you apply for a visa for either a Schengen visa or a US visa, you go to a consulate, they ask you for a series of documents, you know, your bank statements, etc. Now, just imagine if it is completely digital with the consent you are giving, sharing all the necessary details, and you know what exactly details are you sharing with the US consulate. It becomes extremely simpler. So some of the background here is, I'll quickly run past through this in the interest of time, because there are far more interesting questions that have come up than this presentation. So AAs are just data fiduciaries. The AA can charge a fee, and by regulation, AA cannot undertake any other business, cannot store customer data. This is mentioned by the direction given by the RBI. Now, consent is a digitally signed artifact. Consent can always be queried, paused, revoked. They are valid for linked accounts. AA acts as a consent collector, and there is always a purpose. So these are the details of a consent. So there is a validity. When does the consent start? When does the consent expire? What is the mode? Are you viewing the data? Are you storing the data? Query and stream is still some time away. What is the purpose? Is the purpose is for a PFM? Is it for a credit monitoring? Is it for a wealth advisory? Is it for a lending, etc.? Who is the data owner? That's an identifier. And who is consuming this data? Is it HDFC Bank, HDFC Securities, Kotak Bank, etc.? What is the nature of the fetch? Is it a one-time fetch? Are you repeatedly getting this fetch every hour, every day, every month? And what data do you need? Most important part, the data is broadly into profile, balance, and transactions, or summary balance and transactions, which could be bank transactions, account number information, address of the customer, etc. And what all accounts are you sharing the data, and for what date range? And most important point is, how many days or months or year is the data consumer storing this data, data retention? That becomes very clear in this. So it covers all the aspects of a transparency here. Now, at a broad level, what all kinds of financial information is there? One person had asked this question. These are so broadly bank deposits, CASA accounts, and GSTN, and bunch of other things. This is something that is blessed by the RBI. Note that it is all the asset classes, not the liabilities, which means your loan data will not come through this. So some of the terms which we frequently use, FIP is financial information provider. Anyone, it could be health information provider also in a health space. FIU is a financial information user. AA is the account aggregator. FSRs are the four big FSRs, RBI, SEBI, IRDA, and PFRDA, financial sector regulator. So these four have blessed it along with the Department of Revenue for GSTN. And CRS is central registry. Sahamati is the one that is driving this initiative. So this is the way, how does it work? So there is an information user. It could be anything, whether it's an invoice financing, flow-based loan, PFM, wealth advisory, checking my account balance, robo advisors, etc. And then there are a bunch of information providers on the right side of the screen. In the middle sits an account aggregator who validates the consent, and the citizen is empowered to make sure that all the details are shown to the citizen. The granularity of the details are there, and the citizen can always revoke it. So for example, for some reason I give a consent to someone for frequently pulling the data, I can always go to an account aggregator and revoke it, which means I know I'm no more interested in it. So the citizen is empowered with this. Now, something that we have been doing in Perfios, we have been doing this for 10 plus years. We understand these use cases. We've been leveraging largely on unstructured, asymmetric, heterogeneous data, and making it homogeneous. That's what we've been doing for over a decade, and bunch of security, etc. that we do. Now, here, what happened here is, at the time of where you're dealing with unstructured and asymmetric and heterogeneous data with statements and other things, now the data becomes symmetric and homogeneous, which means if I'm getting data from a Kotak Bank or a HDFC Bank or any other bank, there is a predefined schema defined by the RBI and everyone adheres to it. Which means a balance is called, I'll get for every transaction's balance, running amount, check number, etc. Some of the customers of the Perfios will skip this. So some of the use cases that we think of it, we'll get into the details of how do we do this, is largely on the lending, of course, because today bank, the lending is a bigger use case. We've seen in some of you mentioned on an LSP or an OKIN, because that's a credit starved industry, MSME, because they don't have an access to a formal credit. and then credit monitoring. Once you give a loan, obviously the lender and the borrower does not see their face each other. So which means that in a without any user intervention, there is a scope for a credit monitoring where the bank can look for an early warning signals before it goes to convert to an NPA. Investment advisory, financial planning, expense managers, these are the broad use cases that we get. Today, one of the biggest thing for the banks is they don't do a data-driven cross-sell or upsell because they don't have enough data. Kotak Bank or HDFC Bank or SBI has bank data that they own within them. It's called as an held within accounts. So only that data do they have, which means that they cannot do a cross-sell or an upsell considering the 360-degree view of the finances. So I could be, for example, I could be getting my salary in one of the bank account and the immediately next day I'm transferring all the accounts to all the money to another account where I do all kinds of transactions. Now, for a bank, there are only two transactions every month. Salary is being credited and the money is being transferred. So they don't have a complete picture of the customer to do a validated cross-sell or an upsell. In case of any questions, please feel free to interrupt. Glad to take any number of questions.
Vinay, if I may,
yes, if I may
jump in with a quick question. We talked about customers being able to, consumers essentially being able to revoke consent at any time, right? Mm-hmm. So since the consent given is fairly granular and time limited and purpose limited, how do consumers find out what are the consequences of revoking consent? I'm especially thinking of this from the point of view that there may be multiple account aggregators and a consumer may have shared their data and consent with multiple account aggregators.
Correct. So there are two things here. It depends on, let's say, I go to a Perfios account aggregator page and I look at a consent. Mm-hmm. The moment I look at a consent, there is a complete granularity of who is consuming this consent, when was this consent given, when is it going to end, what are the accounts for which data you're sharing, and what type of data is it, your profile, summary, or transactions, and how frequently is the data being pulled. Now, let's say I break the relation with the financial information user. Let's say somebody is offering me a PFM or something. Now, instead of sharing the data there, I come to an account aggregator and say, I want to break this relation, so I'll just revoke this consent. Right? Now, I may have placed multiple consents with multiple account aggregators. Today, unlike a telecom world, there is no interoperability or shifting of users from one account aggregator to another account aggregator. Let's also admit that this is a fairly nascent system, unlike a telecom sector or any other system. So this will come, but over a period of time. I don't see a reason why it should not come. Over a period of time, which means you can log into Perfios AA, view the consents that are expired, and then say that, yes, I want to revoke this consent as this is being shared with a financial information user whom I don't have any relationship with yet.
Got it. And you know, just to follow on to that, to understand the other end of the equation, right? The financial information users, you know, how are they going to reconcile or kind of manage this conflict if it happens that on multiple platforms, the user has given conflicting consent?
When you say conflicting consents, can you please say this case?
So let's imagine that, Perfios and, you know, there's Perfios and there's yet another account aggregator. And let's imagine that mm-hmm. HDFC Bank, is working with both of these account aggregators. And let's say that as a consumer, I give my consent in a certain way to HDFC via the Perfios platform. And then I give my consent, but with slightly different restrictions or slightly different parameters to HDFC via the second account aggregator. So there's a conflict mm-hmm. in this case, right? How, I mean, is this conflict even possible in principle, or how is it going to be managed?
It's certainly possible. It is certainly possible. Let's say HDFC, let's take an argument sake since you brought the HDFC name. HDFC says, I want to give a PFM for my customers to give a 360-degree view of their finances. Today, what is stopping HDFC to do a PFM is there is no regulated, blessed way of getting the data from other institutions, right? Now, I go to HDFC and say, I want to share my data. So for the first time, I use Perfios AA and share only two of my SBI accounts. So HDFC will start getting SBI data. Then I go and share the third SBI account with a different account aggregator. So deduplicate. So yes, there is a case where these two data would be flowing to HDFC, which means HDFC has to dedupe it. But for HDFC perspective, it doesn't matter which account aggregator it is. They will always get the same data. So if for SBI account number two, where I have given it to Perfios AA and to some other account aggregator, they will always get the same data. So the deduplication becomes extremely simpler. Now for a customer, typically the way it works is every account aggregator, whenever there is a data fetch that would happen, they would trigger an SMS to say that your data was pulled by HDFC Bank for this consent. Please log in if it is not for unintended purpose so that you can go and revoke the access. So similarly, the customer would get multiple notifications from different account aggregators. But yes, the customer has that selection to choose more than one account aggregator to share the data, and there could be an overlap also.
Okay, so I think my question was specifically about errors on the customer's side. You know, that let's say the same SBI account consent I have shared with multiple account aggregators, but I have given different levels of consent. And HDFC has to reconcile those two different levels of consent with respect to the same SBI account data from the same customer.
Okay. See, typically a consent has two parts to it. When you say same level of data, the consent has two parts to it. There is a consent template and a consent artifact. Mm-hmm. Now, what is a consent template is, let's take HDFC would say that for this kind of purpose, let's say a loan or a PFM or any use case, it needs your transactions from date D1 to D2, let's say 12 months of data. And it need this purpose to store this data for 5 years, and it will say one time fetch or a repetitive fetch. So far, so good. Now, this portion of the consent is called as a consent template and cannot be revoked by the customer or a citizen. What citizen can do is they can say that I will not accept this consent or reject this consent. Or the citizen says, instead of sharing all my 10 accounts I have across 3 banks, I will only share 2 accounts. These are the things that the citizen can always do. So there is a certain things that the citizen cannot go and negotiate for. This is like when I ask for a payment and the payment is for 100 rupees, in the payment gateway, I cannot go and negotiate it for 90 rupees. Did I answer your question?
Yes, Vinay. So if I understand it correctly, the consent template is not editable by the consumer, and at that point, the consent actually becomes binary. It's either a yes or no, depending on the consent template that HDFC is requested you for. Correct?
Correct. That is correct.
Got it.
Quickly share a different screen so that in case you have an confusion there. Okay, let's proceed with it. We'll come to this case here. So some of the use cases that we've been looking for, onboarding of customer. Today, one of the things is in an onboarding of customer, many people take cancel check. Why? Because they want to be doubly sure of what is the account number, IFSC code, etc. So all it needs is a simple consent for a profile of the customer, which will tell you what is the address, or a summary of the bank account, which will say what is the MICR code, IFSC code, account number, so that you can avoid this and make your onboarding. Fraud analysis becomes extremely simpler here.
This is Ripti here. I am sorry to button, but I had a doubt with what you explained with respect to consent on template. You said that in order to access certain kind of services, there's a template that exists, and a consumer has to give consent to certain things. That is non-negotiable sort of notice, you would say, right?
Correct.
But ideally, if we look at something like a GDPR or a PDPB, where it says that, you know, there shall be no instance where that, the notice shall be non-negotiable, that consumer always should have the right to negotiate. But if, for example, I have 2 accounts in with 2 registered account aggregators, and I want to access certain kind of services, different services from different account aggregators, and I only want to disclose one of my bank accounts in one place and another two in the other place, considering the fact that there's a consent template which pushes me to disclose all the information, do I really have the power to negotiate in the situation or not?
Okay, let's take a counter argument to that. Say there are two kinds of usage for this account aggregator. One is something called as an AA client, which is given by the account aggregator themselves because the RBI master direction demands it. There you can say that please pull my monthly data where you set your consent template, because you are an FIU, as the citizen himself behave as an FIU, where from your Android or your iOS phone, you say that this is the kind of data I need to pull. So you set your consent template. There is no room for negotiation because you are setting it. And then the data is decrypted in your handheld device to show up some meaningful pictorial representation or data here. Right. You have all scopes of negotiation because you are setting the template. You say that for this use case, I am saying I only pull balances, do not pull transactions. Right. And only do it one time or weekly once or once in a month. Expire it after 2 months. You are setting the template and you are completely free to use this in an AA client base. Now, why is an AA client needed? Because it's a citizen charter. Note that the entire account aggregator is a citizen charter, which means you take it as an AA client. You use this for your basic PFM or any such things that you want to do on your handheld device. Note that the account aggregator is still data blind. The data decryption happens within the handheld device. Now, handheld device, of course, will have its own limitations. If I ask for an MSME 2 years of data, it'll crash because it's unable to decrypt it, handle such huge data, etc. Now, let's take a look at the lender use case. Now, today, if you apply for any loan, I'll take one example, apply for any loan. They say, I need 2 years of your IT returns, 12 months of your bank statement, and 3 months of your payslip, right? This is something that they would ask. Now, you cannot go to the lender saying that instead of 3 months of payslip, I'll only give you 1 month. Instead of 12 months of bank statement, I'll give you 3 months of bank statement. You can say, no, I don't want your loan, right?
I agree to that. But the fact that what account aggregator enables me is a different thing that I'm trying to ask. I'm not saying that whether I will be given a service or not, that is obviously a financial information user's call at the end of the day. But I'm saying that whether it allows me to choose what I want to give or not is the question.
As I said, there are two contexts to it. If it is a case of lending being demanded by an FIU, you cannot. You can say, I don't approve the consent, or I will only share 2 accounts instead of 10 accounts. If it is something that you're using as an AA client as a service, you have all this right. So it depends on how you're using this service.
Hi, Vinay. Tripti, hi. I'll quickly try and put that in a perspective. This is Rohit here. So when we look at lending cases or any other use case for account aggregator, there are certain APIs which are exposed, right? There's a specific API which we expose for this information. That API per se cannot be flexible. I want to only give my... So there is a specific template which Vinay spoke about for getting the information. I want my bank information from where the loan has been given. So there will be 5 parameters on that loan information which will be given. That is non-negotiable. That is fixed. If you want to say that, yes, I have another savings account along with it, I don't want to give that information, that is probably a selectable field or a flexible field. But as per for that specific loan account for which the information needs to be given is non-negotiable. I can't keep changing that specific API for a client who's asking me that, right? So there are two. So that's what Vinay is also trying to explain. It is flexible to the extent that you can add or delete certain accounts or add or delete certain financial in the product. But for a financial product, what information goes is fixed, and that is fixed by Revit itself, RBI IT team itself. Yeah.
If I may jump in, and I'm. Could I take a stab at second guessing or articulating some of Tripti's concerns? And Tripti, please correct me if I'm wrong. So let's say that HDFC for a particular purpose to process a loan application, for their credit scoring model, let's say 1 year of my data would be sufficient. But HDFC FTC abuses this non-negotiability of the consent template and insists that I provide 5 years worth of data, right? As a consumer, I don't have any way to negotiate that consent template. So what are our options here? Tripti, am I coming close to kind of articulating some of the concerns you had?
Yes, I also, that is one. I even see that, even foresee that tomorrow, like SEBI or RBI regulates that, and you know, even puts clauses like they are only allowed to take 1 year data and all of those things. So to an extent, it would be those consent templates may be regulated. But even then, like today, if this the idea of having a platform or like you know having this technology is to enable people who do not like who are at the margins and who are not been who have not been able to seek financial financial loans or these instruments because of lack of because of the information being scattered or whatever reason, and they might not have access to certain information. So if you do not give that template is not negotiable at any point, like if it's like so templatized, then how are they expecting a person who's at the margins to be enabled to access these services? That is my bigger question.
So the one answer here is, note that every participant in this ecosystem is a regulated entity. Whether it is regulated by RBI or SEBI or IRDA, it's a different question. But they're all regulated entity, which means they work under a stringent regulations and they cannot afford to misuse. There'll be a frequent audit, etc. Second thing is we are not, so the ecosystem today is not open for any merchant or a kirana shop to become an FIU. It has to be a regulated entity under one of the FSRs. So which means there are some strong guidelines on what do they consume the data, how do they process the data, how do they do the data retention here. And the entire data governance policy here. Second thing is, if you certainly see, say that there is a bank that is abusing, instead of a 1 year or a 2 year, instead of a 12 months data, they're asking for 60 months or 72 months. The entire account aggregators, what it ecosystem provides is, one, you go ahead and reject the consent, saying, why are you rejecting the consent? Because this is absolute nonsense and doesn't make any sense. Second thing, there is an ombudsman and a grievances officer appointed by each AA, and that is directly escalated to RBI, saying these are the cases that are not being handled well. But having said that, look at on the lender side. If they say that I want 12 months data to at least to assess your credit worthiness, and you start giving 3 months data, it doesn't serve them any purpose. Of course, you can go ahead and debate it 12 months. So that's why you have all the rights as a citizen, saying you will reject the consent or you will not approve this consent. You will raise this to a nodal officer and an ombudsman to object to this.
Thanks, Vinay. There's a related question on the YouTube chat from Mukul Singh, who's asking, is there any chance that any entity that is not registered and regulated by any financial sector regulator could become a FIU in the future? For example, a solo app developer wants to create a PFM?
Understand, but not yet. Look at the regulator perspective. Typically, regulator is usually conservative, right? They take a conservative approach. They look at how does this thing, this whole thing would evolve, and then they open it for all. You have many instances of this being happening, right? Whether it's any kind of things that have been handled by the RBI. So my take here is, this will also go through for around good 12, 24 months being tightly regulated. Once they have ironed out all the regulations, loopholes, etc., then they would open it for most of these cases to approach as an FIU. Because the underlying thing, PDP is still in a draft and it's not a bill yet. So even if somebody today misuses it, it becomes extremely hard, because we'll go back to IT Act 2000. So for that individual developer who is developing a PFM app, as of now, no. But in future, certainly yes. I don't see a reason why it should not be.
Thanks, Vinay. Perhaps we can continue with the use cases.
Just a minute, Suchana. You know, The API documentation given by Revit clearly shows that the data consent and data artifact of the consent can be either on store slash query slash stream formats. And in the query formats, there can be pre-populated queries parameters given. So there is a level of flexibility that is already built into that, so into that query format, the third format for the data consent that we're talking about. This is available public information. You can, people are interested, they can look at it in the Revit website. Yeah, please go ahead.
Thanks.
Thanks, Rohit. Okay. So one of the things of today fundamental issue is the fraud analysis. I'm not sure how many people from the banking sector, typical statements, a good 3 to 5% of them are tampered. They take a PDF statement, tamper the name, address, or salary, or balance, and then submit it. Now, in this, with our account aggregator, you're directly getting it from the source of the bank. So it is getting directly pulling it from the core banking system of an, or a, through an API gateway of a Kotak Bank or an HDFC Bank. So this data source is extremely clear, and there is absolutely no room for fraud here. So it becomes extremely simpler in the fraud analysis here. So some of the solutions that can be done here is for various cases, since you brought it, one of the fellow developers said it's a PFM case. See, note that the account aggregator solves only your aggregation problem, which means that instead of the data being asymmetric and heterogeneous, now it is symmetric and homogeneous, and there is a standard way to get this data. It has solved that part of the problem, which itself is a phenomenal thing in considering the past. But the rest of the thing, to massage this data, to analyze this data, to build applications on top of this, etc., is something that every innovator, entrepreneur, or the financial institution has to build. These are something that, which is specifically use case driven. So what is common among all these use cases is there is a consent, and citizen says the citizen agrees or does not agree. It's not something that an FIU is running a bot and to approve all the consents, because the direction clearly says, master direction, the consent has to be approved in the account aggregator page. It's like your UPI. Whatever modes of UPI you go, you still end up in an UPI page where you enter your PIN and approve the payment. So the citizen is empowered with all the knowledge, all the granularity of the data, and the citizen consciously accepts it by giving their agree consent. Yes.
A quick question here, just on the security aspect, and since you referred also to the UPI case, and for those of you who joined the previous session, we had an entire session on security of UPI. I just want to kind of dig slightly deeper on the security aspect, both from an individual AA perspective as well as from an entire ecosystem standpoint. What are these specific technical safeguards? I mean, we know for a fact that in the case of UPI, there is an NPCI common library, but is there something similar on, because the root of the problem we kind of discussed on the UPI in the last session was essentially, how do you ensure that the device binding that happens actually ensures that the person is actually who they claim to be? Because what we've seen in UPI at least is a range of frauds where, you know, somebody does not know that they lost money, and all they did was send one SMS. It's not even sharing of OTP, because the attack took place via some kind of a malware that was installed on the victim's phone. And so my specific question is, since device binding was the identification mechanism in UPI, and even there were some issues, and we do see some kind of security issues. I just want to kind of dig deep slightly on the security aspect on how do you actually identify a consumer and say that, because all the AAs have an app, and additionally on top of it, AAs also provide service through the web, right? I mean, this is something that UPI does not. Ostensibly also for the security reasons, because on the web it's like a lot more harder to authenticate people, because all you need is probably, I mean, OTP is another thing, but how do you kind of doubly ensure, because there could be impersonation risks, right? Purely from a technical standpoint.
Shrikant, I'm sorry, can I just budge in? I think that's a good question. And, you know, there is some we have in account aggregation framework something called VUA, virtual user address, right? And that's one virtual user address, very similar to UPI, which is being maintained in account aggregator as well. One. Number right. two, the onus of identifying the customer lies with the FIP in this case, where he has to ensure that he's an Aadhaar verified, his phone number is verified, his Aadhaar is verified, or his PAN number is verified, or TX number of stipulated identity parameters are identified. So that is with FIP in this case going forward.
Okay, yeah. So just an additional follow-up on that. So that is on the FIP while you're linking the account, right? Let's say I have onboarded one of the AAs and I have, say, linked a couple of my bank accounts for my use, right? And let's say I'm using for a PFM case. And let's say Hacker X then tries to impersonate me because my profile is already there with, say, the AA. I have a VUA, say, Srikant at account aggregator one. And let's say for some reason that's also public, because what we see in UPI is people posting all sorts of their details for grievance register. Let's say, I did this, and this is my VPA, this is my phone number, all sorts of details is there on Twitter, right? So tomorrow, potentially, the VUA also will be public in a lot of sense. And all the attacker needs then is, since it's a web-based system, is just an a malicious app which streams the SMS over is sufficient to compromise the user, right? So I'm more concerned because it's also on the web and not just say strictly device bound.
Correct. So the account aggregator has to make sure that its systems are not compromised and the malicious SMSs are not sent to the customers like this. So that has to be adhered by the account aggregator. The entire cybersecurity guidelines and norms have to be adhered to in that case. But as far as the discoverability of the and identified discoverability of the customer is concerned, that FIP does specifically, and only if the customer says yes, I want to link these three accounts which can be discovered by the account aggregator, those three only go to account aggregator. Also, the consent is not blanket. So to that extent, the damage can be minimized. Even if it is a stream of data which goes, it can be only limited to like 6 months or 1 year or 3 years or whatever time, right? So it's not a unbounded data which goes out. Yeah.
Got it.
Thanks, Rohit, for the answer. And again, even on the FIP, at a broader level, there is a certification criteria for every participant here, FIP, AA, FIU. There's a toolkit, an automated toolkit that runs on a frequent basis to see if there is any built-in loopholes in any of the participants. Second thing is, in an FIP, it validates all kinds of authentication, whether it is through an OTP or redirecting to their portal to access this data or validate them, etc., asking for the back of the grid numbers, etc. That's something that is completely left to the FIP. And again, FIP at every stage will validate the validity of the consent, the mobile number that's being, and the API also provides all kinds of signature and other things.
Right. One quick follow-up here, especially on the FIP scenario. Obviously, banks are kind of slightly richer because they have their own cards and stuff. But let's say, what information does my mutual fund have on me? It's just my name, address, date of birth, PAN. That's the only information that the mutual fund, say, has on me, right? And so what kind of checks can they implement as against, say, obviously a bank, they can say, give me a challenge response on your mother's maiden name or whatever that you've set, or back of your credit card and so on, right? So what the other FIPs, is there like a security arbitrage in that sense?
See, there are two kinds of authentication that the API specification would give. One is a token-based authentication where the bank would, or any FIP would, send an OTP, and you can go ahead and key that OTP and get done with it. to the registered mobile number. The second one is something called as a direct, which means you are redirected to a FIP page, and the FIP is completely free to ask any kind of authentication, whether it could be they could send in they could ask a secret question, 4 digits of your DMAT account ID or any of those things, or last 4 digits of your PAN and last transaction, last 4 digits of your PAN number followed by a secret question. This is completely left to the FIP because each one has their own policy. Even if in Perfios experience, since we've been working with many banks as an FIP, every bank has its own policy here. So some of them have gone back to saying, I'll ask for a grid. And in securities, they will ask for the PIN and a secret question. Similarly, in the mutual fund or some last transaction that has happened, or PAN number and followed by one folio number, that is something left to the FIP. There is, while authentication is mandatory, the mode of authentication is something completely left to the FIP according to their policies.
Okay. Yeah, we can continue. Yeah.
Thank you. So in all these cases, what is the common is the consent. So this is typically how it works. You build an, I put a Perfios FIU module, but it could be any FIU, whether you build it on your own, taking the API specification, etc. So there is a central trust store or a central registry. It's more of a DNS, which has an entry of all the FIP, FIU, AES, their IP address, and the public keys for signing of request, etc. And then you build your various applications on top of this. So in case for any fellow developers and enthusiastic developers to get started, basically you create a sandbox access in Perfios FIU or any FIU, there are a few of them in the market. You create various profiles, and in Perfios, you just integrate 2 to 3 APIs. The reason for that is to abstract out all the complexities that the Revit API provides and the version changes. For example, in last 9 months, we have iterated for 5th version of the APIs. So there is that's a cat and mouse game that any developer has to go through it.
Super sorry to butt in when I hear. I don't have a technology background. I'm a lawyer by training. Can you just slightly explain me how the sandboxes work and how you actually create on your FIU sandbox on the top of the central registry a little bit more? Because like it's just hard for me to grab hold of it with my little bit of knowledge.
Absolutely no issues. See, typically sandbox access, what do we give is there are a bunch of developers doing use case or regulated entities building it, etc. So where you get some mock data, you get started on building your use case. It actually connects to a central registry, and we have a something called as a Perfios Acme bank, which serves as a mock bank to share some hard-coded data. So that's what you would do in sandbox. You're not connecting to a Kotak or HDFC in your sandbox. Once you have done your implementation in sandbox, now you have technically implemented an FIU, you go to Sahamati saying, similar to in parallel lines with NPCI, you go to Sahamati saying, hey, I have done my implementation. Can you run your certification toolkit and validate me so that I put an entry of myself in the central registry? So sandbox access is given only for you to integrate your use case, come up with your use cases and technically implement it, but Perfios will not say that you are an FIU. It is still the Sahamati, which is an industry collective, that is going to say that you are an FIU after running their certification.
All right. So this is for various banks who want to be a part of this ecosystem. They are required to go through this exercise, right?
Correct.
Thank you.
So what Perfios gives is a simpler way on how do we get started on integrating? Can we avoid all kinds of complexities on various Revit APIs, version management, signature changes, etc. Now, Saurabh, to answer your question on the central registry, so treat it as a DNS. Now, there will be a lot of FIPs, AAS, FIU that will be coming in the course of time, right? Now, how do we make sure that every AA, now in this, every AA works with all FIUs and all FIPs, right? Now, that doesn't mean that every AA will visit hundreds of FIUs and hundreds of FIPs office to get something signed. So instead, there is a what Sahamati and RBI has done is there is a central registry. It says that if I'm an FIU, I'll place my record there. What is this record? It only says what is my IP address, what is my port, in case you want to do a whitelisting of this, and the public key from which you will validate the signature, and a couple of other details like name and bunch of other things, and what type of data are you sharing, etc. It's open for public, and all FIPA, FIU entries are there. So what any FIPA or FIP does is it sniffs this data on a frequently basis. The data comes in a JSON format and says that, okay, here is a new FIP. For example, the CBDT or Income Tax Department has come as an FIP. So that's a new FIP that has been onboarded into this ecosystem, or Karnataka Bank has become an FIP, which was not there till yesterday. So I'll give an option for my customers in case they have Karnataka Bank to use the account aggregator instead of giving me a printed copy of their bank statements or any other use case. Similarly, on an FIU also, for an AA to make sure that they validate the request, they know how many, what FIU, from which IP address the sourcing is happening, make the callback, notification, etc. Note that the entire API is an asynchronous, which means it is it's a ping pong mode, which means both the endpoints has to be very clear. And instead of running around between FIU, FIP, drawing hundreds of mails, mail exchange, etc., it will be it's there in the central registry. That keeps things simpler. Now, who hosts the central registry? See, Sahamati is planning to be an SRO. It's a self-regulatory organization under RBI. So once they become an SRO, they would run the central registry as an infrastructure. That's the host, because the onus is on the Sahamati to make sure that any FIP, FIU, or AA is certified, is regulated, is audited, and then they would make a central trust code, which means if you violate your certification, the first thing Sahamati does is remove your entry from the central trust code, which means you are no more accessible to others. Use cases that we saw, we basically help in creating profile. It's like a form filling so that the complexities are abstracted out. You don't get it. You focus more on the use cases and some way to track on how it is being done, and some of the API way. What do you do? There are only 3-4 APIs. You just get integrated and get started on these cases. This is largely for the developers. So what's in it for a developer? What we have done is we have made FIU as a platform, just like you go to an AWS and say, I need an EC2 instance, or for the tech folks, I need an EC2 instance, or I need a Lambda function, etc. You really don't care whether that is in a rack of 16 VMs or 25 VMs, etc. You just ask for it, you'll get it. So that's a kind of a platform that we have done. So you take the API document, you start building your use cases, you plug in and set it. And we give all the flexibility for a data governance policy, which means that is the most important part, in that the FIU platform gets the data. Now, when should the data be purged is something that you get to dictate. And that's the most important part in this. In fact, if anyone can misuse the data here, it's the FIU, because there is an intended purpose for which you have to take the data. You have to use this data for the intended purpose. For example, if I'm taking the data for a loan, and I see that the loan data I did, for whatever reason, I cannot pass this as a loan, can I use it for a cross-sell opportunity? No, you cannot. There is a purpose given by the RBI. And then you need to create, my consent says I have to delete this data after 6 years or after 1 month, or I'm not storing this data, which means you need to define your data governance policy and adhere to it. And if you're storing the data, you need to be very clear on, obviously you have to store within the India and on the security part of it. Answering to Saurabh's question, Saurabh, you need not refer to central registry on every transaction, because it's not that every minute an FIP will be loaded. You can refresh it once in 6 hours or 12 hours or 24 hours. That's something that is left to those who implement it. So again, security is job zero. Some of the things that RBI themselves take care of it. For example, AA is data blind. AA doesn't even know what kind of data this customer has, etc. It just knows it has got a packet. It's a courier service. It takes that registered post from an information provider to an information user with the appropriate seal and address and hand it over there. It doesn't know what is there in that packet. AA cannot monetize the user data, so which means that it cannot take this all the registered mobile numbers and sell it to IRCTC saying that these are your new customers that you can acquire. There is a rigorous certification test being done. And of course, Perfios does some of the internal VAPT, etc. And there is a Sahamati certification at the top of it. There is Sahamati sitting on top of all these things to say, are you following the guidelines or not? FIU is the most critical part here.
On the data blindness. So you said that account aggregators are data blind, and you gave an analogy of courier being a courier, right? But in the case of, say, let's say I give a consent, my consent is spawning across, say, my five bank accounts, but it's going to, say, one particular fintech for whatever reason, let's say lending, right? Now, do you actually say, in the meanwhile, because I remember reading some of this in the older discussions, that AAs can kind of store it temporarily and then repackage it. And so put it in a courier context, can you kind of unpack all the files, put it in a box and ship it to the FIU? Or do you just send these as like five different parcels?
There is a reason why it cannot be done. So let's say this the data encryption is implemented by a DPLMN algorithm. This is typically your mimicking your WhatsApp end-to-end encryption, right? The FIU has generated a key. It sends a public key, and this public key goes all the way till FIP. Now FIP encrypts this data, send it all the way till FIU via AA, and only FIU can decrypt this because it has a private key. Now, subsequent question is, can't AA generate its own key pair, decrypt it and re-encrypt it? Now that's not possible because there is a signature check here, which means the FIU has done and assigned this thing. This is the signature that you should be matching for this key material. It goes all the way till FIP. If it is tampered, the FIP would reject the request right there, saying the key material being signed by the FIU and what is being sent by the AA is not matching, which means AA may have manipulated this data or the encryption key. Otherwise,
So I get in that context, but wouldn't that also say hurt the FIU? Because now if that is the case, then FIP can technically say guess which FIU is sending these.
No.
Or are these keys getting generated for every request?
This key is generated for every request, point one, for every time you fetch a data. Second, for an FIP, data consumer is the corresponding aggregator. It never knows who is the FIU. So if I go to HDFC Bank, apply for a loan and share my SBI data to HDFC Bank, SBI will never know that HDFC is consuming this data. SBI will only know Perfios AI is asking for this data. So there is a sign, there is a mechanism in which the signed packet is sent. So for the larger audience, I can share, there is a GitHub demonstration of how this happens.
Sure.
So there is a slot for data consumer that gets changed in the AA.
Okay. Okay, we can
share. Vinay has a small question, Saurabh here. So like HDFC is giving, I applied for a loan to HDFC. So HDFC raises a request to Perfios. Perfios will in turn forward the request to SBI, right?
Mm-hmm.
And SBI will encrypt the data, send it to Perfios, and Perfios will pass on the data to HDFC.
Correct.
And for the encryption key, HDFC will look up into the central registry to fetch the public key.
No, this is a different key. For the encryption, it's a very different key. What central registry has is, for every API request you make, you need to sign that request. It has a public key for signing that API request. Encrypting of data is a key that will be generated by the FIU, and only the algorithm of the encryption is standardized. It is a Diffie-Hellman algorithm. Whether they generate it for every transaction or only once for a customer, there is a variable called nonce in this encryption key material that has to mandatorily change. Without which the FIP, there is a standard error code saying that this is a duplicate key that you have used. So for every data fetch for a same customer, let's say argument's sake, saying that I'm fetching this data every hour. every hour I am supposed to change the key material. Otherwise, the FIP will reject the request saying it's a duplicate key.
Okay. But see, the only thing which I'm not able to understand clearly is if FIP and FIU don't know who they are, I mean, whom they are interacting with, so how will they fetch my the decryption key from the central registry?
No, the decryption key is not sent as a central registry. FIU generates a key pair. Let's keep park a central registry apart. What the point is, let's say I generate a key pair. Let's take a simplest case. Let's avoid the defilement. It gets more complicated. Let's say that you're generating an RSA key pair. So you pass your public key all the way to FIP through AA. Now the data is encrypted in FIP. It is sent to AA. AA cannot decrypt it because it doesn't have the private key. It comes to FIU. FIU, only FIU can decrypt it. So okay. AA is data blind. Of course, AA has knows all the consent details, which means HDFC asked for this data. The data had to be pulled from SBI and GSTN. And it took, let's say, 60 seconds or 80 seconds to pull this data.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you.
So, see, Sahamati at some point will become an SRO. That's when they've started applying for an SRO under RBI, which means they're also have some stringent guidelines to and accountability to RBI. It's just that RBI will not involve in a day-to-day execution of things, but they are accountable to RBI, and Sahamati would be driving the entire AA ecosystem. So here comes the biggest part is the data governance on this entire thing. This is largely applicable for an FIU because the FIU here is the one who can actually misuse the data, which means the customer can always go back to an ombudsman and a nodal officer to say this has been misused and will be strictly, stringently questioned by the Sahamati. So where are we? This is just a glimpse of how we came here. 2016 is when the master direction came. 2018, when the first roll of tech specs V1.1.0 came out, 2019, Sahamati was formed, and 2020, there is an adoption of some from top five banks and GSTN to embrace AA to share the data. This is where it is. So we are in the fifth version of the iteration. Though Rebit calls it as V1.1.2, we come to 1.1.5 for basically ironing out all these loopholes, etc. So it's a very nascent thing system, and it will be evolving. Because it has its own time of evolution, so the regulator typically does not open it for all. So they would like to control it only for a regulated entities for some period of time, so that all these loose edge cases are ironed out. So the most important part is the for you, anyone who is aspiring to an FI, whether it's an individual developer building the apps or any of them things. Use data for intended purpose only. Note that citizens have right to forget, which means they come to an AA and say, I want to forget all my details in an AA. AA will, of course, keep it whatever is needed for an MIS purpose or an audit purpose. But the rest of it will conveniently wipe it off, which means all the consents would be revoked immediately. That is being shared by the customer here. And then data governance, you need to store the data as per the consent, adhere to the consent, and obviously you have to be compliant with PDP. There's no disagreements here.
Hi, this is Suchana here. If I may jump in with a couple of questions on YouTube chat. So Anivar Aravind asks, what is the possible room for bring your own key for encryption for users?
They can. I mean it's a technical implementation between an FIU and the user. Right. For example, let's take an argument's sake. You need to generate a nonce and the key material. Now, how is this nonce generated? You can as well say the bank may say, hey, I won't generate the nonce, but I'll generate the rest of the key material. I'll give you an, you can relate to an older RSA device or a Google Auth or any such things to key in to complete that as a complete key material and then share it with it. So part of it is generated by the FIU, part of it is generated by the user. Now, in this case, the user may not be a technical person altogether, saying that I need not write in Python or a Java code to generate a key, but I'll say I'll give you an OTP or a mechanism so that I generate the key every time. Yes, it is certainly possible. What AA demands is this key has to be structured in this way. As long as that is met, whether the user keys in, types in this key or give an OTP or some kind of a Google authenticator or a RSA key or something to complete this key is left to the FIU.
Got that, Vinay. Thanks. And there is one other question from Mukul who's asking, is there any timeline when stream requests go live?
Stream request still has a long way to go.
Okay.
View and store, we have somehow getting it. See, note that the banks also have to pull this data from a CBS because the demand is for a real-time data. There is absolutely no, not very fair to say I'll give you T-1 or T-2 data. So this itself will let this evolve, let the banks bring in their use cases, because what makes this entire ecosystem successful is use case. It's not this technical specification, etc. These use cases, keeping security in mind and keeping citizen at the center of it, is what it would make it to success.
Got that, Vinay. And then there is also a question from Rohan. Can you clarify for the anonymity with the HDFC SBI example, what happens if the FIP and FIU are under the same umbrella entity? Jio, for example?
Know.
Okay. So I think, you know, Rohan had, you know, a little bit more on that question. You were saying Jio, for example, has licenses for payment banks, which can offer savings payment systems and an approval to set up their own AA as well. So how is that, you know, how are we going to ensure that AA truly remains a data fiduciary if it's under the same umbrella entity?
See, as per the direction from RBI, AA cannot take any other business other than this, which means it cannot start decrypting this data, monetizing this data, etc. Of course, it cannot decrypt, but it cannot monetize this data, etc. What someone like a Jio or a HDFC, or even if someone gets their own AA license, is saying is, instead of using another AA, use my AA. Because of various operational issues in the commercial part. But let's say...
Sorry, Vinay. So, NBFC AA is a separate legal entity, even if it may be under the same organization, whichever organization people have been. They have to be a separate legal entity. As Vinay rightly pointed out, it can't, you cannot have the same entity as the AA as well as the FIP or FIU. So it's very clear from a regulator standpoint.
On that note, if we could ask Rohit to jump in and maybe, you know, say what he had on his mind for this session, and then, you know, we will go back to questions again after that.
Yeah, I think my question was just basically about the same, this one, that, you know, on paper, definitely these are all separate entities on paper. But my question was that, you know, what is it, what are the undue influences, or what are the extra legal influence that, you know, an umbrella entity can force on these kinds of players, right? That's on these kinds of this one requests. If Jio, for example, is offering both the payment systems, is offering even savings, is offering all of these things within its own umbrella, then will knowing this information, is this going to be of any consequence, you know, in terms of them playing a completely a role of a fiduciary, right? Of who's going to be impartial? Does that really come into effect? That was my question, basically.
So Rohan, yes, Jio has an AA license. Jio has a GSP license also. GSP is very similar to this. It's they are data blind, which means that they are regulated by Sahamati. They cannot get into any other business. And if Jio Payments Bank becomes an FIU, obviously they would ask customers to share data, etc. And again, here it's at the citizen's discretion to share the data or not.
Right. Okay.
Thanks, Vinay and Rohit. Now, if we can just hear from Rohit.
Sure. Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
And you can see the screen, right?
Yes, we can.
Great. So I think I will skip some slides in light of what's been already done, but I wanted to take a quick jab at, you know, the whole piece, the complete perspective of how we are looking at this account aggregation. So customer is the, and as Vinay rightly said, you know, customer is the owner of the data, right? He sells something, he works on something, he needs a loan, he agrees to share data, the data is shared. he sees many types of loans, accepts the best offer, he receives a loan, and he repays the loan. Each of this is supported by various apps and frameworks, and as a certain underlying regulatory framework like a account aggregator, public credit registry, or an Aadhaar, or BBPS, e-liens, UPI, or e-sign, DigiLocker, along with it. So this is just one part of the entire jigsaw that we are looking at, right? That's extremely important. So if you're looking at the jigsaw, it is important to understand that the data that we are going to share is now consented, is regulated, and it is not passed without the basic consumer's know-how between the users and the providers, right? So he's not data blind. He exactly knows who has the data, and he authorizes where the data goes from the provider to the user. So that's the underlying perspective. I just wanted to lay the entire landscape for us to understand where we are from this standpoint. So that was the quick one thing that I think evolution, something that we've both spoken about. But the other thing I wanted to clearly show, and we are in process of looking at how this could be done, and lending use case being one of them. You know, you authorize the data using you're on an app in which you have put in an application for loan. Once you put that in, you have you will get a pop-up. You authorize the application, or then for the account aggregator, and you review and approve the consent going forward. So that's how it will be. It will be like a very similar to the net banking process that we have. I wanted to bring in the element of UI UX here. That was extremely important to see how the account aggregation would work specifically from a UI standpoint for an end use customer to look at. That was the whole thing. There are a whole set of use cases. I think Vin has completely spoken about that. I don't want to go deeper into that. But one part of it, another use case that we looked at extensively was around the cash flow based lending. And this is something that people have been working on. It's a work in progress journey in terms of how a user's PAN, account aggregator, GST, public credit registry, e-mandates with lien and e-sign come together and give an MSME loan. So this piece is extremely important. Somebody spoke about financial inclusion, right? And financial inclusion in MSME space is extremely important. This piece is something which is the missing block currently in our lending for MSME sector as such. And MSME sector is the major chunk of our employment as well as GDP from our standpoint. So so there is cash flow information there is to be had. There is identity information. There is information coming from the existing invoices to GST. The information about past loans which needs to be come through. There is auction invoices if future we need to. There's a repayment history and e-lien on top of that. The signing of the agreement which has to be done. The disbursement has to be done to a KYC bank account. And the monitoring of that has to be done through to report to the public credit register in future going forward. And how the loan is closed at the end of the day. So if we see the entire stack comes together as whole one beautiful orchestrated piece of digital lending for MSME sector. This is something that is work in progress and would drastically change how we enable our MSME sector going forward. And account aggregator is an important piece of this. So that's the point that I quickly wanted to bring about. The application of financial products, I think this has been summed up by Vinay. He talks about the CASA accounts, the term deposits, the insurance, the application of the mutual funds, the stocks and the bonds. Some of them are there. Some of them are still in progress. Moving on, there is a high-level architecture. I think Vinay has covered this. This is a done and dusted piece in terms of how we are looking at. Revit has defined, that is the RBI IT, has defined the API technical norms for these. I will delve deeper into major APIs which have been identified and the tech specs have been laid out for that going forward. So these are the 8 key APIs. So there's a data flow API where the FI uses the account aggregator interface. The FIP data flow API, where you enable to collect financial information for the user. There's an account linking API where you the FI access notification to the user for events and data access events goes to the user. This creates a complete transparency from our standpoint. And then there is consent management and life cycle per se. We had a debate internally and there were questions around how the consent is going to be managed. The entire consent is getting managed in an entire life cycle. If it's a stream, if not a stream, even if it's one-time query, how does the consent get managed? Then there's a key registry which helps the FIPs in discovery of the account aggregators and the callbacks, the account aggregator callback API and the FIU callback API. There are two callback APIs which are there. So these are underlying structure on which the entire piece works on, right? So the tech stack, I think Vinay has covered. I don't want to delve deeper into it, but at a high level, it is important to keep in mind the account aggregator tech stack needs to be API-centric. That is extremely important. We are moving to an era of API-based lending. So the APIs will be extremely important. Who has what access to the APIs are important to that. They have to be, other things are, I think, pretty standard in terms of what the stack needs to look like. And that's all that I wanted to speak about. I would rather encourage people to have some more questions with them. And you know, so we can have a more detailed discussion on how do we actually evangelize this, because we are at a stage where we need to evangelize this. An important point here is that we still have only 5 banks in this account aggregator framework here. Till the time we have the large banks in place and all the banks in place, the account aggregator will not take off, because for some of the information, I'll have to go to the account aggregator. For other information, as a user, I will have to go through individually the financial information providers to get that data on. So that's something that is a hindrance. So it's a journey. Yeah, it's a journey. And I think more evolved economies like UK has seen PSD2, and the PSD2 also has taken a very, very long time to mature. But it's extremely important to evangelize this from a data privacy standpoint, from a data transparency standpoint, and this being part of the building block that we want to achieve at the end of the day, right, going forward, right? So I'll leave it open to questions right now. I kind of whizzed past it because I thought most of the things were already discussed.
See, this is Rohit Joshi here. I have a question. I just want to understand how does the account aggregator infrastructure or the technical architecture fare when analyzed against the privacy of by design principles?
Now, can you specify what do you mean by fail, and what do you mean by design
not
principles?
I'm saying
about the user defined principles, or are you talking about technical design principles?
I'm talking about technical design principles.
Okay, and a technical design principles.
Mm-hmm. I want to know whether the privacy design principle have been applied to the designing process of the technical architecture of the account aggregator.
So these are design principles that individually account aggregators are defining for themselves, right? There is a design principle. If you ask me, this is federated into 3 parts, right? The first part is with the information provider, that are the banks per se, right? How are banks designing their APIs? And as I said, I wanted to only highlight the API-centric approach here. So banks need to define their APIs coming out of their CBS systems in a flexible manner so that they can provide this information as and when required. That's part A. Part B is account aggregator. And believe me, account aggregator is the easier part of it, because we have a white space here. We are building it from scratch. And we can think through the use cases and apply the correct design principles to build it. The third part is the retrofitting it into the FIUs. That when I say FIUs, people who want to take loans, A, B, people who want to give personal financial management advice, or in future, it would be used by the health agencies as well, right? It could be used by health insurance. or for any other other part of you know, financial information that needs to be. So that is retrofitting. So there are three parts of it from a design standpoint in the high level. Banks, which is more legacy, and we'll have to solve for that. B, account aggregations, aggregator per se. Account aggregator is the easier part of it. And C, the third part is the FIUs, where we need to repurpose a lot of user flows and user journeys to retrofit this kind of a regulatory environment for account aggregator. I hope I've answered that question.
Yeah, so I'll take another question from YouTube. What is the possible room for a time-restricted and self-expiring consent? This was asked by Anibal on YouTube chat.
Can you repeat the question, please? I didn't understand.
Yeah, what is the
time-restricted?
Time-restricted self-expiring consent. So I think I'll give an analogy here. It's like the disappearing messages in Signal or Snapchat kind of thing, where the messages are like time restricted and automatically disappear. So can I actually say, like, I want to share this data, but like after a month, like this should get deleted. Let's say I'm applying for a loan and I will know that whether I'm getting a loan or not in a week's time. So is there a way where I can give a consent which says that within a week, whatever data I shared must be deleted? Because that's how long the loan cycle decisioning takes.
So correct. Yes. Yes, Srikant, you can do that. You can actually give a time-restricted consent, and that's how the consent architecture is being built. You, for example, in taking a use case, you need to give a consent for your savings account information, bank statement to be given out to a user who may be where you have applied for loan, and you can give a consent that you need the information for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, so on and so forth.
Srikant, adding to it, there are two parts of expiry here. One part is the consent expiry. Every consent has an expiry. That means that if I say this consent expires today and the customer doesn't approve this consent by today, it gets automatically expired because of the inaction. Second thing is, when you fetch the data, there is a time period for which you would say, either you say that I will not store the data, which means there is no point of debating on the data retention. The second thing is you will say, I'll store this data for X days or X months or X years, which means after that X period, you will delete this data because you respect the consent.
Okay.
So typically, let's say it's a, I'll take a case in point on a foot on street. Now in a foot on street, I randomly bump in a big bazaar, meet a customer saying, hey, are you interested in a specific card loan, etc. Card or a loan or etc. Then I say, yes, I'm interested. He takes his tablet or a paper and fill his forms and say, you will get an SMS on your mobile number with a URL. Take that and approve your consent. Now, obviously that person may do it immediately or do it after 1 day. So in that case, I'll say consent expires after consent. The life cycle of the consent is today and tomorrow, which means by tomorrow midnight, the consent will expire. So that's the expiration of the consent is there, which means the customer has to take an action within today and tomorrow. And then once the customer takes action, let's say this is for a car, typically in a lending, unless you are sure of the decision being made, you may or may not store the data. So if you're not storing the data, take a consent to view only, which means you just look at certain parameters of this, say, and either accept this as a case for lending or discard it immediately.
Yeah. And I had a question, it's open to either of you. You mentioned stream is a while away. Can you expand a bit on the stream? We understand, say, view, store, query, but what kind of use cases are there, say, for stream?
So Srikant, I just wanted to ask something that is on top of the previous question. I just wanted to ask that at a couple of places it is written that account aggregators enable users from
to give their consent when there's a time limited consent framework. So they enable people that if there is a time limited constraint that exists, the users account aggregators would take care of it. But considering the fact that all of these consent templates are super granular as it is portrayed, and that there has to be consent given at that point in time, then how would account aggregators enable if the person is away? Because that is what also it claims apparently in all the.
I can take a stab at that. So typically, let's say I go for an ICICI bank loan and they say, I've raised a consent for you. Click on the URL that you've got in your mail and then approve this consent. Once that is done, we'll immediately process it and get back to you with an answer. Now, for whatever reason, let's say this expires in 48 hours and I did not take any action on this. Now, I cannot approve this consent after 48 hours because it is automatically changed to an expired state of consent because of the reason inaction. Now, once the consent becomes expired, the customer has got one option. Go back to ICICI Bank and ask them to raise a consent again. This consent cannot be changed. Now, there are three cases that I would like to emphasize on. Let's say I take an action on this consent immediately. So I go click on this URL, log into the AA page, approve this consent by linking, associating some of my accounts. Now, as soon as the data fetch happens, the consent becomes expired automatically. If the data fetch is one time in nature, if it is repetitive in nature, it is still an active consent. If it is one time in nature, the data is already fetched. This consent is no more valid. So it becomes an expired state. Now, let's say if it's a repetitive fetch. So let's say there is a PFM app. I have given a consent to say that pull my data every day. Now, so I say that for next 2 to 3 months, I'm not using this app. So I go there and I do a pause of a consent saying that for next 3 months or next X days, do not do any data fetch for this consent. I can come back after a certain period and resume this consent, just like any music player. Or I go in the third case saying that I don't want any, I have cut my relation with this PFM app or this application or bank or any such things. Please revoke the consent immediately with immediate effect. So in which case the consent is, the customer has opted out of this service and then the consent is revoked. Now these are the possibilities that the citizen has. Now, having said that, the revocation of an account, revocation of a consent can also happen when you delink an account. You have linked an account in an account aggregator. Now you delink an account, which means the entire consent becomes revoked if one of the account is delinked. So let's say I go to a branch in SBI where I hold my savings account. I close this savings account. Now SBI is ideally would say that your account with whatever account aggregator it is linked is notified saying this account is delinked and all the associated consents are revoked automatically.
A follow up on that, Vinay, what if I change my registered mobile number at the bank, does it also cascade?
That is an interesting discussion we've been debating. So far, there is no straightforward answer for that. Let's say I go to a bank and say, this is my mobile number has changed. But you don't forget to inform the other participants, whether it's an FIU or AA, it will have a cascade. At some point, things will start failing. It could be in the subsequent data fetch itself. Saying the bank would throw back saying, I have no customer of this previous mobile number.
Right.
I'd like to take a stab at one question on the GST part. Since we've been working with GSTN for long, the right approach for FIU and FIP is to pass through AA because that gives the power for a citizen to pull the data. Let's take an example which Rohit mentioned on the cash flow part. So let's say I have a customer who I need working capital loans, which means I'll analyze their bank statement and GST data every week to say if there is any gap or a variance in their income versus expense to provide a working capital loan. Now, had FIU been pulling the data directly from GSTN, how will the customer go and stop this inflow of data to an FIU or a lender or any of them? For a citizen, if the data flow is happening through an AA, they just go to an AA and revoke a consent. It is automatically stopped. Now, auditing process and for an SI SOP, that's the question number four, is Sahamati is going to audit. In fact, we have already have in a very mature stage of an automated audit toolkit where I can keep as a developer, keep assessing the my framework if it has gone to any changes, etc. We do it on a daily basis. And if there is any violation in audit, I go and fix it. But there will be a frequently audited also by Sahamati on a quarterly basis or so.
Hey, Rohit, you were starting on the stream question that I had asked before. You wanted.
Correct. So, so stream use cases are very specific to wealth management. One of the clear use cases that we can think of, right? And that would be in either personal financial management space or in the mutual fund industry space or in wealth management per se, right? Where wealth advisory would be required. So that's where the stream data is extremely important. Streaming data is extremely important, right? Otherwise, it creates a lot of friction in terms of consents. You have to go back asking for consent to the end user each time the time bounds, right? So you'll have to keep going back to him.
Oh, but wouldn't a recurring consent be enough for that? Like, what's the use case for a stream then? Like, if you let's say a market price information, wouldn't a recurring consent saying that give this wealth
management? We do not have anything as far as I know of recurring consent. It doesn't automatically recur, right? So you have to go back and consent after the time bound consent has been has expired.
I meant multi fetch consent, not a recurring consent. So you could still today give all access to my accounts for a period of 3 months, and they could kind of do an hourly fetch, right? And so when I mentioned in one of the slides.
So universal, that kind of a consent is not built into account aggregator. We used to have that, I know. And Vinay's been working on that for the last so many years with Perfios PFM. That kind of a consent is no longer available in account aggregator.
Yep.
Should we take some more questions here?
Yes,
what are the charges which the user need to pay to AE? Good question. I think this is still a charge question, is still a question around how do you define the market dynamics. We are still in price discovery phase. We are yet to see what the charges would be.
Adding to that point, today, when will the actual charge come in? When the FIP starts charging? Today, yes. The FIPs are giving data free of cost. It won't be that. It will be more like an ATM, where first three or four data fetch is free, the fifth one for that month will be charged. That will change the dynamics of the pricing entirely.
Correct. But they will be charged. So this account aggregator is going to increase the cost of transaction by an incremental amount, some paise for per transaction or something, but there will be a charge inevitably.
They will charge directly FIU. FIU in its own way will charge the customer, of course.
And it will be, the charge will be different for different types of use cases. For a lending use case, the charge will be more, or for some other use cases, it will be less.
Correct. And it depends on the volume of data you're asking for. So let's say you're asking for a 3 years data, the charge is much higher than you're saying on a recurring consent data fetch. I'm asking only last 1 week's data because it's a moving window.
Correct.
So there, it is left entirely to the account aggregator. Yes. On how would they come up with the charging policy.
Correct. And as I said, we are still in the initial phases of evangelizing the concept. So charges are still some way ahead. We have to figure that out still in the account aggregator. There is another question around VUA. Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, just last point there. Regulator will not get into any of the pricing points here. It's completely between the AA to come up with its own pricing. Yes, back to you, Rohit.
And on the regulator does not mandate the use of AA as well, right? So that's why it completely depends on the adoption of this by the users and the providers. So it's left to the demand and supply to evangelize and run the account aggregator in itself. So that's why it will take some time to pick up. Question three, interoperability of BUA. Yes, there is interoperability of BUA, which is there. There is, we all know that there is a central registry, there is a registry at each FRP level, there's a regulator level as well, and at a central registry as well. So there will be interoperability of BUA across AAs. Vinay, you want to add or we go to the next one?
You can go to the next one.
I think you answered auditing as well. That's fair enough. Question five, which is the right approach for FIU? Directly connect with GST or GST data for AA? Because connecting directly with GST gives FIU more flexibility as compared to. Inevitably, GSTN data will be separate from the account aggregator data. You have to understand, financial provider as of now are all NBFCs or all the RBI regulated entities. We have still not moved into a use case of health or a telecom, right? Or GST as a use case, which looks to be some years ahead. But yes, to your point, once it is directly connected, the account aggregator can pull the data to GSTN and provide the information. GSTN, it will be much easier to get the data from account aggregator than going to GST. Vinay, you want to add something?
Couple of things. In fact,
automatic, I'm sure you know about that.
So yes.
Can throw a light on that.
APIs
work around there, yeah.
Couple of updates there is we've been working on that OCEN and LSP, where even for an invoice financing, GST data becomes extremely critical. So there is, it's a work in progress. While there is no clear date on when it will be completed on the part. And there is a work in progress both technically on GST and getting onboarded as an FIP, and even in terms of a paperwork between the Department of Revenue and RBI, because the Department of Revenue was not under the first four FSR that came onboarded for the account aggregator system. And for an MSME loan, GST and data becomes extremely important.
Correct. So moving to question six. Could you please shed some light on the timelines pertaining to different data points available in AA ecosystems? Timelines are market driven. I think I've clearly said that. We have five banks here. We have four or five clear account aggregators who are in operation and in principle approvals to additional ones as well. But we are still waiting for the market discovery to happen to get the timelines on. So, it could be 2 years or more. Vinay, you want to add on to that?
Sure. SEBI in principle, SEBI IRDA in principle has agreed to this account aggregator because they're a part of the FSR. But unlike RBI, they haven't sent a formal circular to all this entity saying, please share this data. Because there are a couple of ways to even for mutual funds data you can look at saying, why should every AMC share the data? Why not the registrar share the data? Because they have the data. Similarly, why should every security share the data? Why not pull it from NSE or BSE? That becomes simpler instead of asking 300 plus securities to implement it. So that these questions will be answered when the time is right. But SEBI in principle has agreed. When it will send a circular formally to ask the participants, etc. More than SEBI, I think it solves a bigger problem for IRDA. Or it's insurance companies.
Correct. So there is something called an inter-regulator body which we'll have to delve deeper into this and come with the right notification for the participants to follow on top of that. Now, so let's go to question 7. Can AA also tie up with derived data provider as per OCEN? No, AA cannot tie up with any other data provider unless data provider is mandated by NBFC AA as an FIP. OCEN is still in concept space. We are still building the pieces of OCEN as we understand. I don't think the AAs can tie up with the derived data provider as of now. Veena, you want to add?
Sure. No, AAs cannot, because even if it's a derived data provider, it has to be a regulated entity, a provider, and there has to be a defined schema, etc. that has to come. Just like the schema is defined for an PPF, or a public provident fund, or an NPS, it has to be a regulated under one of the FSRs and has to have a proper schema, etc., which means that it's a derived data. Let's say, argument's sake, let's say Zomato is giving a derived data of a restaurant or an MSN. Let's take that case. Now, the derived data, which means Zomato will serve as an FIP, right? Which means Zomato will have or anyone who's sharing the data will have a standard schema and a standard way to share this data for any FIU to consume.
Correct. So the next question is, if any FIU wants to join AA's ecosystem, then it is who's responsible to inform Samathi to get entry into registry? So first of all, if you want to enter an AA ecosystem, you have to get an NBFC AA license, which is a specific license from RBI to do that. You cannot get it like that. So they have mandated certain regulations around it. So that's on that side. But if any account, if you're asking about the discoverability of account aggregator within the ecosystem, that is done through the central registry itself. So there is a central registry where the discoverability of the account aggregator ecosystem is taken care of as a problem set. Yeah. Could you please explain a little about the onboarding process of an account aggregator system? For the onboarding process of an account aggregator system, I think it's best left to the RBI. It's a regulatory matter. They would look at it in depth and come up with their own mandate. So there is, if I remember, it has to be a separate legal entity. One, number two, there is certain X amount of raised capital for that, and it has to adhere to certain other strictures like that. It's there on the website. If you can quickly go there and figure this one out. Veena, you want to add it on something there?
The question is more on an FIU. If they want to join an AU ecosystem, it's a simple step process. You either build an FIU or use somebody who has already built an FIU as a platform, plug into it, do an integration, inform Sahamati saying you've done the integration and you are ready to go for a UAT stage. They would run some certification in your UAT, and then you have enabled yourself as an FIU. It's a straightforward process. Of course, the prerequisite is you have to be regulated by one of the FSRs.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. Question 9. Some account aggregators have developed their own client systems. How these account aggregator clients work out and how different are these from the normal LOS? Account aggregator systems cannot run their own LOS. That's very clear. According to the regulator, they cannot run their LOS. They can have their own client systems. Vinay had explained that when he was talking, they can build their own consent mechanism, which can be given by account aggregator. The account aggregator can have their own consent mechanism, but they cannot build their own loan origination system. They cannot use the data or the consent data in any form or manner. Yeah. Any credit underwriting decisions can be done on these client portal? No, client portal cannot be done. So credit underwriting cannot be done by account aggregator. Vina, you wanted to add something?
Yes. See, the AA client has a restriction of doing things within a handheld device or a mobile phone. which means it cannot analyze a 1 year transactions data to come up with some score or something, because decryption is a CPU intensive task. And though most phones says they're octa-core, etc., they're obviously starved by the hardware. So yes, what AI client typically can do is it can get the balances, show you the balances, week on week your balance changes, and it has to store this decrypted data within the handheld device only. It cannot send back to an AI server or to store the data. So for AI client to expand in a big way, it is constrained largely by an handheld device, and AI client cannot share this data with some other one, some other FIU, for a different purpose. Because that is again violation of the consent, because AI client also takes a consent saying this is being used for a PFM purpose within the app, etc.
Correct. So any more questions?
So one question to Vinay is on the SDK model of AA. I know some AAs have an SDK model. So could you please expand that on, again, from a security standpoint, because we still have a lot of these UPI apps that are not, say, again, bank specific. So these are non-bank, and they're called UPI parlays. It's third-party application providers. So would there also be a case for similar pay in the account aggregator space, where there would be like apps that are not, say, directly involved in consent management, but say they can plug in your AASDK and so on?
Very unlikely, because if you're dealing with consent, you are a regulated body. That's at least sure. Now, AASDK is more of a convenience. Let's take the UPI history. What happened when the first UPI came is, I want to make a payment in Amazon, let's take argument's sake, and I go make a payment via UPI. You only come back with set of instructions saying, open your Beam app, enter your PIN, go to pending payments, approve this payment, come back and refresh here. There is a disconnected journey. That's how the first cut of UPI was. Of course, it evolved in a very big way, convenience, etc. So what AASDK says is, instead of the customer going from a HDFC bank to some AA to download to from Play Store, doing all this processing, that I'll give a seamless way of integration, but the still adhering to the master direction saying the consent approval will happen in the account aggregator page, which means the customer has to log into the account aggregator via PIN or OTP or some mechanism. It is just a convenience way so that the user journey is within that particular app. But none of the principles have been violated here, which means the consent has to be given in the AA application after logging in by the customer. Otherwise, FIU can raise a consent and run a bot to approve this consent.
Yeah, and still the consent data is only available with the AA, not with, say, anyone who integrates GST.
Everyone, even FIU, FIP also has the consent data. It's just that the way, the kind of data that they have is there is some variations. For example, SBI will only have the consent that is pertaining to SBI itself as an FIP. It wouldn't know whether Kotak was an FIP or HDFC was an FIP. Similarly, HDFC would has this customer has given, is sharing data from SBI, Kotak, HDFC, etc. AA has a little different format of the consent, but the consent template, everyone has the same format, same data. When the consent expires, when who is the data owner, what is the periodicity of the consent, when will the data be removed, etc.
I think the SDK is more of a CX innovation, or a CX, not innovation, but a CX enabler in that sense, right? Rather than doing a in-frame or doing a redirect, you're just embedding the SDK there and doing it. It's like Amazon embedding a lending SDK of any bank or any NBFC, right? So that they don't have to move into another screen and the client gets a seamless experience. So account aggregator also, since it's an additional step, has to look at ways in which the customer experience does not get hampered. And SDK is one way of doing that.
There is another question from YouTube from Akshay Vijay. What happens if an FIP doesn't want to join the system?
Yeah, that's a good question. If FIP does not want to join the system currently, well, they can't. They will not. There is no regulation forcing them to join the system. but it is just the market forces which will pull them into this. Yeah, sorry, Vinay, you're saying something.
Yeah, thanks, Vinay. Srikanth, it goes by the principle of reciprocity, just like in the very initial days of Bureau, saying that if you want to be an FIU, you have to be an FIP. You can conveniently say that I don't want to be both FIU and FIP, which means you will not participate in this ecosystem. RBI is not putting a regulatory stance, unlike Bureau in the current scenario, saying you have to be an FIP or an FIU. RBI says if you want to be an FIU, you have to be an FIP.
Okay. Any other questions? We're almost come to the end. I'll wait for a minute for anyone to ask any other questions.
Srikanth, hi, one small query.
Yeah,
this is regarding, might be a bit late to ask, but I was just thinking, like, if say if a user is linking his account in the account aggregator, what I understood through the session is like there are two ways. One is token based and one is direct authentication, right? Hello. Am I audible?
Yes. Yeah, audible.
So, token based, why? What I understood is that the bank will be sending him an OTP which he will enter in the account aggregator app. So it will link. Now, direct based would be an offline transition between the user and the bank, or will it be through feature provided in account aggregator's app or something like online banking or something like that?
Saurabh, this is typical to your the way e-mandate can be set. You will be redirected to a bank URL. You need to take the action within the stipulated time, which says 5 minutes or 10 minutes. And the what kind of authentication that the bank would do is left to the bank. They may ask a secret question or a grid number or 4 digits of your card number, etc. But it is not an offline process. Because the moment you go, it is an offline process, it defeats the purpose. Of course, you have a time limit, so you need to act within the time limit.
No, offline, Vinay, understood. Offline, what I meant to say offline is suppose I am having my HDFC app in my mobile. So if I initiate a linking process, I will get a notification on my HDFC app that he is asking, we are asking for a request to link, kindly approve. So if you approve, then it redirects me to account aggregation. Is the linking successful? Something like that, or will it be through the account aggregator app only? That's what I was
asking. Linking has to be initiated from the account aggregator. You cannot initiate linking from an FIU.
Okay.
Right. So we'll use, let's say, argument set. You use Perfios AA and say that you want to link it to HDFC. So you will initiate a process. You will discover your accounts and do a linking. Now it is up to HDFC whether for this customer they would do a token based or a redirection based, and they would redirect you to their net banking page.
Okay.
Or some other page to authenticate.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Rohit, Vinay, you want to give some closing thoughts?
Sure, Srikanth. See, the way that AA ecosystem has evolved, because I've been part of it since 2016, etc., it's come up to a good shape now. Now it is more to make it more secure, bring in more use cases, looking at the larger picture, and it will evolve like any other standards, whether it's an open banking, PSD1, PSD2, etc. It will evolve in its own way, depending on the use cases that would fill. And definitely the financial institutions are looking forward to it. Of course, they will run their own InfoSec and other things to it, but they're definitely looking forward to it, because here comes a way that is blessed by the regulator to pull the data. The existing means is something that the regulator has not object to it, but that doesn't mean that the regulator has completely blessed it also. So in the AA space, it is a completely blessed by regulator. So the banks can willingly ask for the data through an account aggregator. And there are multiple use cases like an OCEN or an LSP or a marketplace, etc., that will be leveraging on the AEA for various credit, whether it's a credit enablement or financial inclusion or wealth advisory services, etc., or even now something like a buy now pay later types. So these are it's an interesting time in the entire Indian finance industry. AEA has come up in a good shape. We have some top five banks, GSTN slowly moving towards it. Of course, this is not something that would happen in overnight. So kindly be patient. But please keep raising your concerns whenever you have questions about the security of the AEA in terms of the citizens' rights being violated or any such things. Over to you, Srikanth.
Sure. Rohit, you want to add some thoughts?
I think this is the first step in terms of data transparency and privacy. Obviously, this has to be enabled with the law in the parliament. We assume and hope that law gets passed quickly. But having left the universe level questions, the God questions to for them to answer later, for us as account aggregator, evangelists, I think it's extremely important to look at UI as an innovation across the account aggregator. So there are two things that are very important so that this succeeds. One is obviously the UI. We should be very careful not to disrupt the existing customer experience. That is the first thing. The second part of it is around the charge mechanisms around it. And, we have to ensure that we are delivering value for the end customer and they understand why they have to pay an additional whatever what they need to pay for, whatever they get to see the value out of it. And that has to come by the core ease of getting the entire application process end to end. So trying to tie it down with my entire, the ecosystem piece where we are either looking at a large use case of lending or wealth management or getting additional use cases over a period of time with health, telecom, GS, tax, that kind of data onto this. So account aggregator will make it easier to get the telecom, health, tax data also onto the same platform. It's a journey, as we all agree. But this is the way in which we can get that data easily. Otherwise, the way telecom data is getting used is completely black box for the end user. As I don't know where my data, or I don't know as so your telecom provider knows a whole lot about you, which I don't know how he's using. At least with account aggregator, I exactly know how it is getting used. So that's the third point that I would like to put on. But these are clear three areas. We need to keep thinking as people who are trying to work in this area, keep thinking of one, use cases, second, UIs, how do we keep the customer's experience seamless around. Yeah, that's all from my side. Thank you.
Okay. With that, we'll close the session. Thanks, Vinay and Rohit, for joining us today and patiently explaining, answering the queries. And thank you all for joining us on a Saturday evening. I hope you had a bit more clarity on account aggregators and keep the discussion on. And if needed, we'll probably have another session sometime later. If you want to stay tuned to more payments discussions, join us our Telegram chat on t.me/cashlessconsumer. With that, I'm calling the session for close. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you all.